can I do for you? He say, oh, you don't know me, but I'm supporting you. I'm only a security guard. But I wish, oh, sorry. Someone this morning came to my house and said, he's a security guard. And he just wanted to donate some money to me. He knows I'm in a forum this afternoon. So he gave me $200. I think you need the money. Don't only like you security guard. We can do find other ways of getting $200. But why don't you keep for yourself? He said, no. You need money. We want you to get into parliament, and so that you can fight for us. And this $200 is nothing. So I look at him. I said, no. Please take it back. He said, then he pushed it to me. I said, well, I will accept it and donate to this afternoon's forum. And I thank you. And I look at him and say, well, it's people like him who give us the will and the strength to continue in this struggle. It was good that he came. And then that's why each time it's not easy to be in opposition politics, but when you look at such support, you really want to do your best and continue the struggle. Okay, I say this also with a certain aim in mind. There are some donation boxes outside. So I see that it's not filling up. You know, I used to attend a lunch given by Michael Bloomberg, and he would tell me, you know, you are enjoying one side of the balance sheet. The other side of the balance sheet is the inflow coming into my account. Can you please put some inflow into my account? And Michael Bloomberg has got $4 billion, and yet he asked me for money. I don't have much, so I asked him for money too. So we need a lot of money to continue with this struggle. So do whatever you can, $5, $10 is all right. We are going to start a donate button on our website. Please donate $5, $10, $50, $10. Okay, we want to be like Obama, getting $700 million from the public crowdfunding. All right, please do your share, $10, $20, and there is also a membership form. You can actually do more to help us by becoming a member, and then membership form is just there. Everyone is holding it up at the back. So fill it up, we contact you. Some people, a few of you asked me how to play a bigger role to help us. So this is give us your contact, we will contact you. I think we are all gearing up for election in September. It may not or it may happen, but we are gearing it up. And we need a lot of help and we need a lot of money. Okay, but let me come back to my topic. How Singapore can succeed without PAP. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Can you? So, but actually, the forum question, can Singapore succeed without PAP, assumes that Singapore has been successful under the PAP all along. Is this true? Okay. Is this true? Has Singapore succeeded under the PAP in the last 10 years? I just take the 10 years because who are the winners? Who are the losers? Right? Even in an economy, there are different people. Some win, some lose. Some businessmen make money, some others lose. Others go and commit suicide, others just have more wives and mistresses. So there are winners and losers in everything. It's a zero-sum game, all right? But under SingFirst, we make everybody progress. Look at it in 2004. This is when Mr. Lee Hsien Loong came to power as Prime Minister, 2004 in August. I divide Singapore into three classes, income classes, the poor, the middle class, and the high income group. The dividing point is the starting point for the middle class. there are several definitions of middle class, but the definition that I use, there are no standard definition of middle class, but there is one which is being used and is done by Pew Charitable Trust. It's an American charity. He has given a very, because he's in charge of giving out money. So he wants to know who is poor, who is middle class before he decides to give money. So he defines middle class as people earning between 67% and 200% of median income. So if you have a median income of 1,000, then if you earn between 600 and 670 and $2,000, then you are considered middle class. Below that, below 670, you are poor, poverty, then you deserve help. Above 2,000, you are considered high income group, okay? Here it is, high income group in 2004, 20% of Singaporeans are in the high income group, earning above, this is $4,000. The median income in 2004 was $2,000. So 20% of Singaporeans earn above 4,000. Then the poverty class are those earning below $1,340, okay? $1,340. 26% of them. Middle class, more than half, 54%, earning more between $1,340 and $4,000. But what happened 10 years later? 10 years later, the high income group improved to 22%. The poor has been, more people have become poor, 30%, 31%. And the middle class has shrunk. The middle class has shrunk and is now only 47, 48%. All right? So you have more poor and a smaller middle class. Is this what you call success under PAP?
Is it Sing dollar or US dollar?
Huh? Sing dollar, Sing dollar. We're all in Singapore. Don't make me happy. I must give credit to Roy. Roy prepared this chart for me.
Roy had wanted to come, but he's down with flu. Roy Nung.
Message me that you cannot come. He's okay. Down with flu. Roy Nung. Yeah.
I am using a lot of charts because we discussed a lot over the last few days until 1 a.m. Every night we WhatsApp. What is the. Yeah, please.
2014 prices, adjusted income, adjusted to...
No, this is just gross. Based on gross. Raw, gross income. Because the definition is... Okay. In 2014, the median income is 3,000. So you are middle class if you earn between 2,000 and... $2,010 and middle class is 6,000, okay? Between 2,000 and 600 you earn in 2014, you are considered middle class by Pew's definition, okay, by the definition of Pew. So poverty class is 31%. Whatever definition you use, it is stated that it is quite acknowledged even by economists in the NUS, three of them acknowledge that the poor constitute about 30% in Singapore. 30% of Singaporeans are considered poor, okay? Even Tommy Koh also joined in, you know, 30% go to school without breakfast, school children, 60% of students are on student loans. Okay, is this success? More people. This is what, is this first world? They talk about Singapore progressing, but this is what you get. It's getting worse. But there is hope. Because we offer a program that will bring Singapore, raise Singapore status to a first world nation. How we can succeed is, we look at success, we will not boast about first world infrastructure, world class city, the most livable city, and yet you have a third world nation. Third world nation means society is broken and people are not happy, and when you have 30% of the poor, people are poor. So our goal is to be a first world nation. And how do we consider ourselves first world? There are several criteria. I'll go through the criteria of what constitutes a first world nation. And then examine where Singapore stands now. For each criteria, how does Singapore compare to first world average? And then I will propose a program that can transform Singapore into a successful first world nation. All right? So what are the criteria of first world? I will analyze it using 10 criteria. And in each of these criteria, I will have first world, Singapore under PAP, and SingFirst. A bit too arrogant to say Singapore under SingFirst, but anyway, it's coming back. So, these 10 criteria, egalitarian society, welfare, protection of workers, strong family support, education, healthcare, transport, retirement, political culture, and economic policy. Sorry, those of you at the back cannot see. Political culture, Okay, political culture, economic policy. Economic policy is last, but it is not least. Definitely, I will tell you how we can sustain first world using our economic policy. So I'll go to the first criteria, egalitarian society. Long word, but it means equal. First world, what does the first world constitute? Egalitarian society. It has got a broad middle class. Low income inequality, Gini. That means there are not many people, not big extremes of income. No, this one, I'll look at, where is it going to? Let me see, okay? I want to go back, reverse, how to reverse it? Reverse back. Doesn't work. Okay, we will come back. Let me see, where is this then? Gregory? How do I go back to the slide? The previous...
You want to show a graph, right?
Yeah, I want to show a graph. There's a graph here. Okay. No. I want to show a graph. I showed this. Five to six. This one, how come? Okay, good. Gini coefficient, inequality of income. Singapore is the highest, 0.42 right now, okay, after all the transfers. The rest are all, according to the World Bank or IMF, if the Gini coefficient exceeds 0.4, we are in danger. Danger meaning people not happy, there'll be riots and all that. We are in danger zone for a long time. I don't know why Singapore has no riots, but I'm not suggesting that we have riots.
Little India.
Got Little India, but then the foreigners. So even all these are developed countries, they're all way below 0.4. America is 0.7. UK is 0.3. So this one, okay? The best is Denmark, 0.248. So, this is in danger zone, right? Okay. Sorry for this. Okay. And then we have poverty. The poverty in egalitarian society is about 10%. Okay. Singapore versus developed countries. Singapore has the highest poverty rate of 30%. Everybody, you look at it, the EU average, the average of European countries is 10%, around 10%. Of course, you have the US, a lot of other countries that are, and the best is Finland, only 3% poverty rate. There will be poor people in every society. So even though you're first world, it's not everybody is rich. So there are some poor, these are handicapped people and all that. All right, so this is where we want to, okay. Okay, Singapore under the PAP. Singapore under the PAP, you have elitism, cronyism. The economists have come out with an index on global cronyism. This is a very serious finding that Singapore is number 5 in the world on the global cronyism index. How we're politically connected. Businessmen are most likely to prosper. So you are politically connected. If you are in business, you are not connected politically, you got no chance. But it means cronyism. And this is not what we say, this is what the economy say. We has got, and this comes under Russia, Nigeria, Malaysia. So we are number 5. We are not in very good company. So PAP doesn't like to hear all these things. Suharto was toppled because of what? NKK, right? Cronyism, corruption, and nepotism. Singapore has high income inequality, as you can see, 0.42. Shrinking middle class, as you can see, the middle class has shrunk from 54% to 48%. And the rising poverty from 26% to 31%. Basically, these are economic statistics that you should ask PAP when the next general election comes. Are we better off now than we were 10 years ago under the same Prime Minister, Lee Hsien Loong? So the chances, I'm quite optimistic that we will make a good impact. People will vote for us. The only thing is fear. The only thing is also about the civil service. That is why we organize this thing, that do not fear. Civil service is here to maintain it. And you just vote for the party, don't give your vote to the party that has made your economic life worse. And this is what happened. SingFirst, how will SingFirst do it? We have an equal and fair society, broad middle class. We will reduce the Gini coefficient to below 3.5%. And I'll tell you how we're going to do it. And we'll reduce poverty from 30% to around 10%. So welfare, first world, broad consensus among political parties. Everyone agreed there must be state welfare. Second is high government spending. Well, generous benefits. Singapore under the PAP, self-reliant philosophy. Welfare is a dirty word. It has the lowest government expenditure, and it has got severe. It's not generous. In the West, they give it to you. You ask for it, we give it to you. But here, you must have generous. So, government spending as a percentage of GDP, Singapore is the lowest. 17% of GDP, the rest all spend half of the GDP on state welfare for people. All right? So, SingFirst believes in a strong safety net, increased government spending, and universal and general safety net. No means test. Everyone will get what is given, including the middle class. Even Wee Cho Yao wants $300 a month, we will also give to him. He said, no, $1, we also give to him. And I don't laugh, because Wee Cho Yao pays more tax than all of us combined. So he deserves it, $300. So workers' protection, first world, minimum wage, employment security, due process of termination, unemployment insurance priorities for citizens. Singapore under PAP, no minimum wage, short-term contracts, hire and fire, no unemployment benefits. Even the civil service, they changed to 2-year contract, 3-year release, is bloody nonsense. I mean, when you are joined the civil service in the past, it's permanent staff. All right, token priority for citizens, the liberal immigration policy. SingFirst will give you a minimum wage, permanent staff in place of short-term contracts, longer notice period, okay? We don't just hire and fire. We give you maybe 3 months notice, 6 months notice. In fact, we're thinking maybe civil service, to maintain the neutrality of the civil service, we want to bring back pension for the civil service. Yes. Remember, they were converted to CPF. We will give pension back to civil servants so that they can continue to work in peace. Whichever is the government, you will get your pension when you retire. Okay, unemployment insurance. We will think of unemployment insurance. It's easy. CPF employer, CPF contribution, 2%. Out of 2%, our total wage bill is $154 billion wage bill. 2% is $3 billion. Every year we get $3 billion. That will be the pool for our unemployment insurance. Workers leave their job for the first 6 months, you get your money. Of course, not last round pay, because the ministers will get $1 million unemployment benefit. We are going to set them out, but they are not giving them $1 million for 6 months. So we will give them Singaporeans first. Singaporeans will occupy top positions. By mean, all the CEO, chairman must be Singapore citizen. Foreigners, you become assistant or become technical specialist. All right, CEO, CFO, financial CTO, technical officer must. All the C's must be Singaporeans. Strong family support. In the first world, you have family cash benefits. Subsidized child care, 90% in the Nordics. Generous maternity and paternity benefits. Singapore under PAP, baby bonus quite good. 6,000 for first baby, second baby, third, fourth, 8,000. But only one off. After that, you have to look after them yourself. Core saving, yes, core saving. You save, you put in 100, government will put 100 for 6 years, up to 6 years. That's good. Expensive childcare, tough means test of means test, all right. But under SingFirst, we will enhance all the baby bonus, make it better, co-saving better. But in addition, we give you child allowances of $300 a month up to the age of 12, all right. Child care center will receive 90% subsidy, like in Norway and Finland, okay. When your child reaches the age of 3, it's compulsory by law, you send to child care center. Government will pay 90%. So Singapore, $1,000, government will pay $900. $100 you take from the child allowance of $300. $100 you got it. So it's free. Enhanced maternity and paternity leave. Education. First world free or heavily subsidized. They will provide highest education possible. Small class size. Singapore under PAP, expensive. School fees are low, but parents spend more than $1 billion on private tuition every year. And heavy student loans, university students graduate with $20,000 to $30,000 loan. Before they start working, they already got a loan. So big class size for most students, except for those on gifted program and the IP program. 40 students per class, right? For most students. Elitist, the education of the PP focus only on top scorers, right? And neglect the majority because 60% of them graduate without skills that employers want. So, you know, one minister even said you cannot eat degrees, so what for we send you to university, right? SingFirst will give you free education from primary one to university. We will give you smaller class size for all, half of what is not just IP or gifted children. Double the number of teachers, better terms of service to raise the status and raise the target of cohort of students entering university from 30% to 50%. Right now, 25% of students from the primary one will end up in university. The PAP target is 30%. Our target is 50%. That's first world. Half of the students this going to primary one now will end up university. The other half will go polytechnic and ITE. Healthcare, free, first world give you free and heavily subsidized. The state pays more than 70%. 80%, more than 80% Japan and the Nordics. And you have 2.6 to 13.4 hospital beds per 1,000 population. 2.7 to 4.2 doctors. 7.8 to 16.5 nurses for 1,000. This is a very good ratio. Singapore under PAP, expensive. Government spend only 1/3 of total health spending. Long wait, only 2 beds for 1,000, 2.1 doctors, and 6.9 nurses. Under SingFirst, what will we do? We'll raise government subsidy from 1/3 to 2/3. Double the beds, hospital beds to 21,500 to build another 10,750 beds. How do we do it? We will have a one hospital in every GRC. Average hospital, 500 beds. So 10,000, you need 20 hospitals. There are 15 GRC. We give 5 extra. Double the doctors from 2.0 to 4.0 hospital beds for 1,000. 10 nurses for 1,000, not from the present 6.7. Much big, a lot of old people that we need nurses to take care. Much bigger intakes of medical nursing students in local institutions, better terms of service to reduce the stress of medical staff. This, I love this table. It captures everything about transport policy in just one table. First world, Singapore under PAP, and Singapore under SingFirst. So, public transport, private, it also reminds me of what the late finance minister, Mr. Hon Sui Sen, used to tell us as officers. He said, you draw up so big tables, nice tables. How am I going to read out in parliament, budget statement, how to read? You're going to write out every sentence, then I can follow writing. But that's Mr. Hon Sui Sen. But this table is good. I started off by trying to do a table for all the 10 criteria. Okay, 10 criteria, all, but find very difficult. Only transport can put in figures, the rest have to put in words. Total, we all spend, this is from the 2012 to 2013 household expenditure survey of Singapore. In Singapore, in the first world, they spend 2.5% of their household expenditure on public transport. Singapore under PAP, we all spend 3.5%, $170 per month out of total expenditure of I don't know the figure. So 3.5%. Under SingFirst, we'll reduce it to 2.5%. First world. Private transport they spend 13.5% in the first world. In Singapore, we spend 27.2%. Okay. 17. And in SingFirst, we will bring it down to 12.5%. How do we reduce proportion of house expenditure to 2.25? The footnote one, reduce fares by 30%. We will reduce fares across the board by 30%. And 30% out of $170 is $51. So we will save you $51 every month. Not $50 once in every 50 years. They give you 50 years, you can queue up. Under SingFirst, we give you $51 every month. This is $2012. Okay, now would have gone up more. In 2012, the average family spends $170 a month. So we are going to give you back $50 every month under SingFirst. We will remove COE, okay? Because ownership is very expensive, all right? And we'll reduce usage. You know, first world very high, 7%. Singapore, only 6.5%, because Singapore small. Other country, big, they have to ride longer distances, so they spend 7% on usage. In SingFirst, we will reduce it to 6%, okay? Because we will bring jobs near to homes. and then we will provide you with cheaper public transport so that you can switch to public transport. Retirement, the first world gave you, the state gives you old age pension. In Singapore, under PAP, you pay for your own retirement. Self-funded CPF, minimum sum, annuity. But on top of that, they shortchange us on our CPF savings. They give you only 2.5%. When they Malaysia give you 6.7% or what? And that is the return of sovereign wealth fund. They achieve around 6% everywhere in the world achieve around that kind of return. But they give Singapore also achieve that kind of return, 6%, but they give you only 2.5. So they shortchange you, okay, by 3%. We will discuss this in another public forum that we are holding in August on the reserve, Singapore reserves. Have they shortchanged you? That's in August. Make a note of that. We will have Leong Sien has agreed to speak just now.
Leong Sien,
so,
where's Leong Sien?
Leong Sien is here, yeah?
Yeah, the back, Leong Sien in the back.
He will speak. I also got another person, a retired banker, he will speak also. We will examine how much reserves does Singapore have. They refuse to tell you, but we make estimate. If we are wrong, you tell us the correct figure. So this is one day of challenging that. Okay, you say you we are wrong, we are stupid. Okay, you clever, you show us the figures. So we will, how much reserve does Singapore have? Have we been shortchanged? Don't we deserve more? These are the three topics we will talk, and its relevance on CPF. SingFirst, we will restore the CPF with raw age to 55. We will give you in return, in addition to your CPF, we'll give you $300 a month for your pension from the state. We have money to do it. Hey, what happened? Okay. This doesn't mean CPF saving disappear, no? Old age pension, and we'll increase the return on CPF savings from 2.5 to the market rate that is achieved by the GIC and all that. Every year they achieve about 5-6%. Minimum, Chao Chao also 5.5%. Also 5.5%, they give you only 2.5. Okay? So we will sell new HDB flats at cost, so that enough of your CPF savings are left for your old age. Right now, you spend so much for your mortgage, you don't have enough for your CPF savings. This is why more than half do not have the minimum sum. Political culture, the next one, we're moving beyond economics. What is the political culture in the first world? I hope Bertha Hansen stayed behind so that I can address her question. Mutual respect, diversity. She has to go to another press conference,